everyone, this is Jason here from Nathaniel, and in this lesson we are going to take a melody, in this case a very famous melody, Ode to Joy, and do a lot of rhythmic modifications to the melody. Normally whenever we mess around with a melody, you know, in a sense of making it more interesting, we tend to add a lot of harmony, we tend to add a lot of bass movements or counterpoint or, you know, fancier chords and extended harmony and whatnot. But in this lesson, I wanted to solely try to explain how rhythm can come into play as well. So if you're a piano player, or if you're a guitar player, or if you're any musician who plays melodies, this lesson could be great to kind of take the melody and make you sound a lot more sophisticated rhythmically, right? Now, it doesn't mean that you can't play some advanced chords. In fact, we have this lesson sort of divided into two parts. The first part is the one which you're watching now, which is on YouTube. And to carry it forward, we request you to click on the link in the description and head over to our Patreon page, where you could support us, number one, and also download an entire booklet where I have this whole song notated with chords for a basic player as well as with chords for a more intermediate or advanced player, along with all the notes from the lesson you're watching right now on YouTube. So I would urge all of you to check out the link in Patreon and head over there and support us. So let's get started with the lesson. The first thing I want to do is to bring in what we call as time feels in music. So a time feel for me will be if you take the tune. So right now this is the pulse, right? The tune is on the pulse, which is 1 2 3 4, 1 2 3 4, 1 2 3 4, 1 2 3. You just have that one division there. So Lord of glory, Lord, da, da, da. So that was the subbeat where the composer has divided the beat into two parts, right? So for me, a time feel is sort of a system which you set your mind in such that you constantly follow that, or you constantly follow that division system of the beat, as I call it. So if I have to divide the beat by two and just count it for you guys while playing the melody, it will be something like this. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. We use this and terminology to make it a bit more easier to speak. You wouldn't want to say 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8. You don't want to play it. You don't want to add more numbers, because then it defeats the purpose of feeling the subbeat as something very different than the main beat. So you need to accept the fact and acknowledge the fact that the subbeat is going to be a very excited kind of a feel, right? It's going to take the song to a different rhythmic level, right? And make it more groovy and more exciting. Okay, so you go 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, and 2 and... So what we want to do is not change the melody at all. We want to respect the melody. And this is a great song. It's a great melody to begin with. So we don't have to do much. All we are trying to do is just make it a bit more rhythmically interesting. So if you try and add the and, you see what's happening? I have started adding that subbeat feel. Otherwise, it would probably be like a pulse, which is nice, isn't it? This will be really good if you're arranging for a choir or a string section where everyone sing the words together, right? Joyful, joyful. So then the soprano is doing that while the alto perhaps is doing joyful. Or joyful, joyful, we adore thee. That would be the tenor, and then joyful, joyful. joyful, that'll be the bass. So if you want all the notes to run in parallel rhythmically as well as rhythmically, then you don't need to divide. You can still play on the pulse and rely on some really good harmony to back you, right? So that's not what this video is about, because I can't teach you to be rhythmically cool when you're just on the pulse. So if you're on the pulse, you may, like I said earlier, you would need to focus on a more choral arrangement or a string quartet or a more orchestral vibe where everyone play the same thing together. So let's say you're on a piano or you're on a fingerstyle guitar or a banjo, you know, these sort of instruments where you can adopt some rhythmic phrases, the chords, as well as the melody. So in the case of a piano, I could play the melody in my right hand and play the time feel in the left hand, which is currently eighth notes, right? Or divide by two. But you see, the melody is still fine. I can even harmonize the melody. So that's something cool which I thought of talking about. And what happens is, with the time feel, you can also incorporate the time feel with different parts of the, like for example the piano, you can go something like, you see, I'm actually doing it with one hand. So depending on your ability to play the instrument, depending on how you want to express yourself, just keep the time feel in mind. So time feel is nothing but the eighth note dividing by two, and then we move on. So the next time feel you could have is the triplet. So if you have divide by two, which is one and two and three, and the dividing by three, which is the triplet, will be one and two and three and four and so one and a two and a three and a four and a is a very sort of conventional way of counting a triplet. You could adopt it, or in India sometimes you can say conical phrases like takita 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 takita. And if you go back to eighth notes, you could do tak tak tak. Well, whatever works for you, really, just to feel the distinction between the main beat and the subbeat. So if I do triplets and incorporate that feel, never lose the melody, right? Keep it in there. Make sure that with all the rhythm stuff you're adding, the melody is still retained. So get this going. And get that triplet. So if you go to eighth notes, triplets, that's triplet. So again, if you haven't heard this song, you should definitely check it out. Ode to Joy by Ludwig van Beethoven. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. Anyway, so that's the triplet rhythmic time feel. And then to move forward, well, you can keep moving forward. All you're doing is you're giving yourself, or you're giving the beat, a lot more options and giving it a lot more spaces to fill. Right? But the speed of the beat, or the speed of the pulse, if you observed so far, has not changed. Okay? So if I divide by four, that'll be called as a semi-quaver, which we can say as 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4. Right? It's just easy. It doesn't become a tongue twister. So right? work really well for a nice folk vibe, I guess. And if you're a guitar player or a banjo player, I would encourage you to try this out on those instruments as well. Even though I'm showing it on the piano, in theory, this could work on, if you're a fingerstyle player or a banjo player or a mandolin player or a veena or a sitar player, whatever you do, right? So you go one and a two. While triplets would have been... semi-quavers. And the time feel, which in this case is semi-quavers or 16 notes, is always sort of like the maximum division system in your brain. It's not, it's like you're probably not going to go beyond that unless you want to do like a flashy roll or, I don't know, something like that to just show off a little bit here and there, you know. So the think of the time feel as the maximum you're going to divide the beat for most of the time. However, you don't have to always divide by 4 and keep that as a mechanical law. You can also not divide. You can do something like... see what I did there? I did just simple crotchets or quarter notes, you know? By the book melody, then... and then I went to a triplet. And then I can go... something like that. I could then add a semi-quaver there. So you could mix and match. You can sparingly use time feels. Maybe when the part of the song, maybe when you go to the B section, I guess, right? Now you could bring in the time feel like a triplet or a semi-quaver. Go back to triplets or whatever. I hope you're getting the idea. In the sense, pretty much any melody you take, which is sort of on the simpler side, you know, it could be a classical tune like this, it could be a hymn, it could be a pop song, it could be a jazz song, it could be whatever, or a folk song. What I'm trying to say is the melody is strong enough. The melody is driving the song, but the excitement and the more groovy and the thing which makes people move, dance, and, you know, enjoy music in that sense, perhaps is lacking. And whenever you feel that's lacking, whenever that intensity is lacking, you could bring in the time feels, right? So, yeah, you should try this out. And then we also, I mean, if you really want to take it to the next levels, you can even divide by 6. So dividing by 6 will be... you know, fast triplets, you know, 16th note triplets. So if you wanted to count that, I don't even know how I can count that, but it can be something like, you know, I don't know if there's any official way. I just know up to 1 e-ander. So you could do something like, that's like 1 2 3 4 5 6, 1 2 3 4 5 6. So the each beat is getting divided by 6, so you have so many more amazing spaces to fill, right? And that's the beauty about time. You can measure it this way, 1 second, 2 seconds, 3 seconds, or whatever, but then between the 2 seconds or between the 2 beats in musical terminology, you can have so many subbeats. So as long as you're dividing them equally, and as long as you can divide them and practice them and execute them equally, I think people are going to enjoy what you're doing, right? Of course, it's going to make it a bit more intense and a lot more sophisticated. But that's cool. So you go... so... see how slow the melody is, right? To accommodate all that. you can sort of build it. So what I'm trying to show you in this tutorial is just an idea. It's not how to play Ode to Joy. It's just different styles of playing pretty much anything using rhythm. So let's just recap until where we've come. So we have the time fields. We have four time fields. We have divide by two, one and two and three, and then divide by three, one triplet, one and two and three, and then we go 1E and 2E and 3E and 4E, and then you can, I even showed you dividing by six, which you need not do if you think it's annoying. Like, right? But try to keep the pulse pretty much the same or the melody the same. So if you do divide by two, divide by three, divide by four, six. Quite like six actually. For some strange reason, even though you're playing more notes, it's actually making the melody lazier, right? For some reason, right? So it just changes the intensity around. So just acknowledge the fact that you have all these subbeats going, right? So practice this. If you want, what you could do, you could pause the video right now, practice it, and then return back, because I'm going to take this forward to the next lesson in pretty much the same video, right? And what I'd also urge you guys to do, if you wish, is please head over to the link in the description. It'll take you to our Patreon page where you can support us for this video and for help us release more videos like this. And you'll also get a nice study guide and a booklet and all the notation, including two of my arrangements of Ode to Joy, one for beginners and one for more slightly advanced people. Right, so let's now move on to rhythmic devices. So once you have your eye on these things called time fields, which divide the beat into certain amounts, the rhythmic devices, as I call them, just take up the entire time field and look at permutations around them. So if I start with maybe division by three, for instance, you know, if you have, and if I count like one triplet, one and a two, right? One and a two and a three. You don't have to play all these divisions, right? Even though you are dividing the beat by three in your mind. So you could let the divisions, let the division by three happen, but you don't have to play all these divisions. You can clear up some space, right? So instead of doing maybe all the beats, you could maybe do tick X tick, tick X tick. So that'll be one and a. So you don't play at the and, you play at the a of the triplet. So you're actually sort of swinging or shuffling this thing, right? Or get a more folk vibe going if you want, right? So, or you can combine, you can do, that was all triplets, so that's like tick 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 with a tick X tick, right? If you think of it that way. So I've just written these ticks and X's, you can check it out on the screen. So you have ta 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 ta. So that's the basic feel. Again, don't compromise the melody. Keep the melody running. Right? Or if you do division by two, maybe you could do one and play both. Or you can be like one and. Like, don't play the one, just play the and. That'll be represented as X tick. One and. Or you can do one and, where you're not even dividing. So you could do something like, So my left hand on the piano is going like one and two, and I'm lifting it every alternate beat, or every alternate beat I don't hit. Tick, tick, X, tick. Okay. You have a nice rhythm along with the melody, right? And you're in the eighth note time feel, you're dividing by two. Quite like that. Three. So instead of doing da 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 in a very possibly like a very machine gun like execution, you can perhaps look at these time fields to just free up some gaps. As the great Mozart said, music is defined as the silence between the notes. So you need to keep the silence when you play, right? So let's see how time fields can work with maybe a semi-quaver feel or a 16 note feel. So maybe we can do, so all the semi-quavers will be 1E and a chik 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 chik, right? So if you want to remove the E, you can try chik 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 chik, like a gallop feel. So you need, if you can first vocalize it, what I would suggest is vocalize the time feel along with the melody if you can, in a very crude unofficial way, whatever works for you. Tang chaka dang chaka dang chaka tang chaka tang chaka tang chaka tang chaka tang chaka tag 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 tag. Right, you could get the tick tick X tick tag 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 tum chaka tum chaka tum chaka tum chaka, or tag tag, or oh, I did that earlier. I can do what can we do? You can do dagadang tagadang tagadak tagadang 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 tagadang. This is all in dagadang 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 gallop tang chakatang chakatang chakatang. So I hope you're realizing that whatever I'm showing you right now, vocalizing, the fact that I kind of can do it, I'm able to do it, also will imply that I can also do it on my piano or my guitar. So it's very important when you look at your principal instrument to always vocalize it and imagine your part. And then I'm quite certain that you can eventually play it. Yes, it's a lot of hard work, but the imagination part is something you need to do first. So vocalize it, like what I did with these silly phrases. Tung tagadam tagadam parabam parabam. Anything. I really don't know whether there's some official way to say all this, but just do whatever works for you. So if you want to get a kind of a 16th note feel with a little bit of gallop, it's still dividing by four, right? One and one E and a, one E and a, right? It's also a great practice tool. You know, you're taking a song you're doing and you're just trying it out in different flavors, or perhaps a good arrangement and production tool as well. The whole idea I'm trying to make is any melody which has ever been released can be presented in all these time fields. And once you present it in the time field, we just talked now about rhythmic devices which can take that to an even greater level, right? So that's about rhythmic devices. Perhaps you could pause the video, practice it a bit, and in the same video, I'm going to also look at a little bit on polyrhythms, right? And while you pause the video, do also consider heading over to the link in the description. I know I've said that before, but yeah, I'm saying it again. So head over to our Patreon channel and support us by purchasing a PDF notebook, if you will, of all of what we're talking about, including the notations of Ode to Joy, including two ways of arranging it harmonically, which I have done for beginners as well as some more advanced people, right? Moving on. If I look at a polyrhythm now, like a polyrhythm, there are a lot of videos on YouTube which talk about a polyrhythm being constructed through all sorts of incredible ways. But for me, I just want to get by. I just want to get going. So I'm going to show you a trick of using polyrhythms with the melody to kind of stay with the time feel discussion, but at the same time bring about this different feel. Like you get a 2 feel over a 3, or a 3 feel over a 2, or a 3 feel over a 4, or a 4 feel over a 3. So we can get these results quite quickly and quite easily. You just have to be aware of what you're doing. Okay, so let's get started. Now if I play the melody, right? So if I divide this beat by 2, right? 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and if I only tap the pulse as you're hearing here, nothing is really subdivided or feeling cool, right? So what I do is just simply tap out what we call as a dotted note sequence, where you go 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and... So what happens is it depends on the time signature. It also depends on whether the melody is on that time signature, whether it'll recycle, and a lot of other geeky stuff. But what you could do is if you just keep a dotted feel, 1 and 2 and 3 and... While the melody does not keep a dotted feel, it plays on the pulse. So you'll end up hitting one on beat and one off beat in succession, because that's what a dotted feel does to music. It will take on, then it'll go to off, and then it'll come back on, and then it'll go back off. It's going to never do off or on, especially in the dotted quarter notes, which we are doing now. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 3. It's a bit weird, right? So perhaps you could try that 1 and 2 and 3. Maybe before the melody comes in. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. Right? With the melody. See, it eventually resolves and it becomes like an acquired taste. So if we have to enforce it on our instrument. So if you see my left hand is pretty much attempting this dotted feel. For simplicity, I'm just playing the root. You see what's happening? So again, the great way to count it is 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, right? And try to internalize it. So another trick which I found which works is away from your instrument, away from your piano, wherever you are. Let's say you're having lunch or you're in the shower or absolutely jobless, right? What you could do is just hum the melody. And the more relaxed you are while doing this, I guess is a function of you being good at it, right? So try to, initially it's going to be very chaotic, but push through. And if you can actually sing this on the dining table or in the shower or in such environments, right, you're going to eventually get it on your guitar or piano or whatever you play, right? So the trick which I found to work for myself and a lot of my students is distance yourself a little away from the keyboard, right? Practice some social distancing, if you will. So go a little away from the keyboard, do your thing, understand the concept, come back and do it on the keyboard. And it just somehow comes together. So you do tan 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 tan. It sounds quite groovy also, right? The moment you do it, you can say that it's syncopated. You can use that word, I guess, when nothing is really meeting each other in with the two limbs of yours. Okay, so this is what we can call as a two feel, or using dotted quarter notes, right? You can check out the link where I've given you all the symbols and how you can count it and map it out really well. So essentially you're doing one and two and three and four and one, and the story goes on, one off, one on and one off. Now when you look at a three feel, or a triplet feel, or what I also, or what we also call as a quarter note triplet feel, right? Because a quarter note triplet is dividing two eighth notes by three, which is interesting, as opposed to an eighth note triplet, which is dividing a quarter note by three, where you go one triplet, two triplet, three triplet, which I showed you earlier, one and a two. So here we maintain a one and a two and a three and a feel, one and a two and a, but we don't play all these beats. We do one and a two and a three and a four and a one and a two and, depending on the time signature of your song. This one is on 4/4, so I guess you can go all the way to four. It'll resolve and cycle itself, recycle itself very well. One and a two and a three and a four and a da, 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 so on. One and a two and a three and a four and, right, this is what I want you to practice. One and a two and a three and a four and a, right? So you see there's no repetition of beats. One and a two and a. See, I did not do two a's in succession. One and a two and a. Both, all the three, the beats, the main beat, the off beat, which is at the a, and then the next off beat, which is at the and. One and a two and a three and a four and a one and a two and a three and a four. So and so on. Right? So it's a little tricky to do, so I would suggest maybe do only the piano and then with the hand, and then bring in the hand later to do something like, you know. I quite like that. It brings a like a folk vibe, right? Right, but if you guys really like the original classically composed song, well, I deeply apologize, because we are going to change it around a bit, right? But I still didn't change the melody. If you observe, we've still not changed that melody. It's still Ode to Joy by Beethoven. So you go, so one and a two and a three and a four, all right? And a thing for you guitar players, piano players and all, what you'll find is once you add more and more rhythmic elements to your music, it's going to make holding the harmony and the melody a lot tougher. So your chords are going to struggle. What you could do earlier, you may not be able to do now, because the rhythm has entered the party, right? So the melody and the harmonic elements may need to be simplified. So if you're doing a lot of chords, maybe chill out on the chords. Maybe if I just take the D chord, don't change it, just hold, focus on the triplet. And slowly but surely you can start wandering off. So that's about the three feel, or the quarter note triplet feel. And the last time feel, where you can make it sound like a polyrhythm, is where you can use 16th notes, which is 1E and a 2E and a, and use what we call as a dotted eighth note effect, right? So that'll be an eighth note which lasts 1E and a, and that a comes when you put the dot there, okay? So just check out the notes which you can download at the description. So you go 1e and a 2e and a 3e and a 4e and a 1e and a 2e and a 3e and a 4e, and it's like taking forever to resolve, right? But that's the fun of dotted eighth notes, right? Very tricky to practice, which is why I've saved probably the best for last, if you will. So you go 1e and a 2e and a 3e and a 4e and a 1e and a 2e and... See, it's never a repetition of anything, because the structure of 4 is being divided by is going in 3 parts at a time. So the odds for it to repeat are, it's going to take a long while, right? So you go 1e and a 2e and a 3e and a 4e and a 1e and a 2e and a 3e and a 4e with the track. So 1e and... So whenever you're playing the melody... So first, now imagine you're doing a 16 note time field. So 1e and a 2e... Right? And don't make the melody go with the time field. That's sometimes what I do by mistake. So 1e and a 2e and a 3e and a 4e and a... Right? So this is the normal pulse. And then the dotted feel. I try to keep this very, very consistent, and after a while, I guess, don't think about it too much. It should just be like a plane or a machine in autopilot mode. So if I have to execute it on the piano, as I said earlier, start simple. Okay, now be careful. You don't want 16 notes to become triplets. That's a common mistake I found with people, including myself. So instead of doing 1 and a 2 and a, you want to go 1e and a 2e and a 3e and a 4e and a. Get that pumping in your head. 1e and a 2e and a 3e and a 4e and a 1e and a... Right? 1e and a 2e and... You may not be able to count it. I think that's okay. As long as you've done it with your hand before, your body knows it, right? You don't... There's a saying where you have to count everything while you play. I don't know if that saying always works. Sometimes it may even make the process more mechanical, right? So anyway... It gets really groovy because you're in that 16 note mode. And the cool thing is, with all these polyrhythmic phrases or polyrhythmic additions, if you will, we have always been on a time feel, right? So whenever you make a mistake with the polyrhythm, it's cool, because as long as you stay on the time feel, you still generate a very nice musical phrase. Like if you make an error doing 16th notes, for example, and a 2 and it's fine, it just sounds like another rhythm. But just know, when you're just doing like a cool rhythm over 16 notes, or in fact a dotted eighth note kind of pulse. Okay, so these are the three things I wanted to share for this piece, Ode to Joy, or any piece. So in conclusion, you take any melody you like. Start with this one, since you're watching the video. So take a melody, a simple melody, which has like quarter notes, eighth notes and stuff. And then slowly but surely explore all the time fields, which are eighth notes, triplets, 16th notes, and the 16 note triplets, which is divided by 6. Then what can you do? You clear the way a little bit by adding rhythmic devices. Okay. And then... We've also looked at how you can take the time feel and make it even more sophisticated by bringing out this polyrhythmic feel of 3:4, 4:3, and so on, right? So some of you guys may be wondering, you know, what are the chords which you played and all that? Well, in this lesson, which has already been quite long, thanks for staying this far, by the way. I thought, if I had to tell you the melody, the harmony and the rhythm, it's going to be a super long video and it may not serve the purpose of what I wanted to convey, wherein I want to teach you this rhythmic addition which can happen with any melody. It doesn't have to be Ode to Joy. I just chose Ode to Joy because of how great it is, how popular it is and all that. So, to learn the melody, to learn the chords further, do head over to our Patreon page. You'll get a booklet which has been handwritten by me. Let me just give you a glimpse of some of the stuff which we have there. We have all this stuff, and as you can see, we've also notated the song, which is a nice thing to have and learn. And you also have the arrangement of the song, which I've done in a very simple way using diatonic chords. And I've also done an arrangement using some really exciting slash chords, secondary dominants, a few jazz chords, a few augmented chords and non-by-the-book chords and so on and so forth, right? So do consider heading over and picking up a copy for yourself, and you can also support our school channel in the future, for the future, where we'll be hoping to do a lot more stuff for you guys. Right. In conclusion, this is Jason here from Nathaniel, and also I hope that all of you guys are doing safe and staying strong around this time. It's a trying time for all of us musicians and music lovers out there. But yeah, keep at it, stay strong, enjoy yourself, take care of yourself. Cheers.